This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning. Welcome one and all to the service of worship. We're glad you're with us this morning. At the end of the pew on the center aisle, there is a pad. If you would, sign your name and pass it down. And when it's returned, note who is worshiping beside you and greet them accordingly. First, I'm going to call Owen Hand forward for a moment of stewardship.
I'm pleased to be here this morning to discuss stewardship. It's been my privilege to have done this a number of times in the past. And we have so many positive things that have happened to us this year. Our church sent 20 youths, including non-members of the church, to Jamaica in July. This was their first international trip, and they have been given a new sense of appreciation for what we have. The Walk for Water mission, setting new records with 661 registered walkers, raising over $75,000. It's hard to imagine that a morning walk can provide clean, safe drinking water for over 30,000 people. Last year's summer vacation Bible school topped out at 55 participating people. We have opened the educational building to nonprofits, including Alcoholics Anonymous, which meets here Monday through Friday, Young Lives, Teenage Mothers and Children, which meets here several times a month, and the performances as part of Piccolo Spoleto. Seven families have joined our congregation, in addition to 10 youth who have joined through confirmation. And there's a new member class scheduled today. Our heating and air conditioning keeps us comfortable. The choir loft enhancements have enhanced our enjoyment of the music and worship. I've been privileged to serve as one of your elders for a number of years. At our last joint session meeting with the diaconate and the incoming new officers, I was moved by the statements of faith shared by these incoming officers. I wish you could have been here to have witnessed that yourself. The commitment to our church by these new officers is exciting. Last but not least, we are refocused with the launching of our sailboat church, being guided by God's Spirit to lead us into uncharted waters. So with this year's accomplishments as a foundation, we're just getting started. We need your pledges to chart our course. For those of us taking required mandatory distributions from our qualified retirement accounts, don't forget that you can have part of your pledge, not taxable, by having it sent directly to the church. God bless you and thank you.
Thank you, Owen. Today, immediately following the worship service, you're all encouraged to stay just for a few minutes. There will be a short congregational meeting. The purpose of this meeting is to fulfill the slate of officers for elder for the class of 2022. Following that, there will be a plaza social, weather permitting, and we are seeing clear radar. Also today, immediately following worship in the fellowship hall, there will be a new member class. A number of people have signed up, and if you're interested in membership and have not signed up, please don't hesitate. Come over, we have room for as many as are here. Next Sunday, October 27th, we will worship at Stony Creek Chapel in McPhersonville at 11 o'clock. That will be followed by lunch, and the deacons will be providing fried chicken and desserts, and you are all encouraged to not only come, but come and bring a savory side dish. Again, that service will be at 11 o'clock. And please note the first hymn is hymn number 722, not 772. So it's 722. Let us now turn our hearts and minds to the worship of God as we call ourselves to worship using the words printed in the bulletin. How I love God's law. God's commandments and teachings are always with me.
How sweet are God's words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth.
God's new covenant is written on our hearts so that we may all know God, young and old, powerful and powerless alike.
How sweet are God's words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth.
In the word we hear, the good news of the gospel, salvation is ours through faith in Christ Jesus.
How sweet are God's words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth.
Seated. The new covenant God made with Israel and with us begins in forgiveness. Though we continually break covenant with God, God remains faithful in the sure and certain trust that God will forgive us and remember our sins no more. Let us confess our sin to God as we pray together. Gracious God, we confess we do not meditate on your commands and teachings all day long. We do not keep your word before us and all things. Instead, we turn away from your demanding truth and wander toward easier options. Forgive us, we pray, for pursuing our own desires rather than yours. Forgive us for growing weary and following you, for failing to pray and work tirelessly for justice, for losing hope in your power to transform the powers of this world. Tune our ears to the sound of your justice. Turn our hearts to your commandments and word of grace. Do not remember our sin, but remember your mercy forever. We pray in Christ's name. Thank you. hear the good news. God promises to forgive us, to put our sin out of God's own mind and heart. In this way, God gives us not just a second chance, but a new beginning. Believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning. How's everyone? Well, we're hoping that the rain will finally stop and we can be able to play outside this afternoon, right? Yes. Well, this morning I want to tell you about a couple of things. One is I want to share with you some books that are really, really important books to me that I have collected over the years. And then talk a little bit about why those books are important. So, first one here, what kind of book is this, do you think? Yes? It's a Bible, that's right. And this is a particularly special Bible for me because this is a Bible that belonged to my mother. And it was given to her by her great-grandmother, and then she gave it to me. And in it, there are words that have been written about and to and from her and her family. And so it's an important, it's not one that I use all the time, but it's one that means something to me because it belonged to my mother. And then I have another one in here, and this one belonged to my great-grandmother. And same thing for me. The fact that this was a part of something that was in my family for a long time has made this a really important book for me. And then next we have, yeah, this one's really old and well-worn and used. This Bible belonged to my grandfather, and he was a preacher just like I'm a preacher. And so in this particular Bible, there's places where he's written notes about different scriptures and all sorts of things like that. And so it's an important Bible to me, but you know what, y'all? It's not my favorite. My very, very favorite Bible that I have is this one. And can y'all see what it says down there on the bottom of this one? Can y'all read that? It says... For those of you who can... Quinn, tell everybody what it says on the front of there. It says Patrick. It has my name on it because this was the very first Bible that was given to me when I was about probably your age, some of you. And when I was 6 years old, this was the Bible that I was given. And the same way that some of these Bibles have things that are written in them about different Sunday school classes and sermons and things that happened, I wrote in this Bible from the time I was a little bitty person, and so I've always wanted to hold on to that and take good care of it. Now, this morning there's going to be a passage of Scripture, and in it there's a man named Paul, and Paul was writing to somebody that was like a son to him, and his name was Timothy. You know about Timothy. Well, Paul wrote to Timothy, and he said, every part of God's word is God breathed. Can you say that word, God breathed?
God breathed.
So Paul was telling Timothy that everything that's in the Bible has a purpose and a use. What's great about that is sometimes you read a passage of Scripture and it means something different today than it might have meant to you 5 or 10 years ago. And sometimes what you find is that there are stories in there that you can find your way into. You look at the characters of the story and you think, you know what? I know exactly what they're talking about because I either feel like that too or I need that too. So here's what I want you to take away today. I bet that all of your families have at least one, maybe a dozen Bibles at home. And I want you to find mom or dad or grandma or grandpa, and I want you to ask them about two things. One is if they can show you a Bible that is special to them and tell you that story. Will you do that?
Yes.
And then I also want you to ask them to share with you one of the verses in that Bible that's really important to them, because you know what? If it's important to them, I bet it will also be important to you. Okay? Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for your word, for the way it tells us stories about Jesus and about us. Help us to read. Help us to listen so that we will learn and love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Y'all can either go back to your families or to the Sunshine Club.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
Our epistle lesson this morning is from Paul's second letter to Timothy, beginning with chapter 3, verse 14. I'll be reading from the Common English Bible. Listen now to the word of the Lord. But you must continue with the things you have learned and found convincing. You know who taught you. Since childhood, you have known the Holy Scriptures that help you to be wise in a way that leads to salvation through faith that is in Christ Jesus. Every scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for showing mistakes, for correcting, and for training, so that the person who belongs to God can be equipped to do everything that is good. I am giving you this commission in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is coming to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearance and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be ready to do it, whether it is convenient or inconvenient. Correct, confront, and encourage with patience and instruction. There will come a time when people will not tolerate sound teaching. They will collect teachers who say what they want to hear about what they are, and they are self-centered. They will turn their back on the truth and turn to myths. But you must keep control of yourself in all circumstances. Endure suffering, do the work of a preacher of the good news, and carry out your service fully. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Will you pray with me? Lord, indeed, it is our prayer that you will hear us, that you will give to us what is needed now. We recognize the need that we have for power and love and grace, and we express our thanksgiving to you for placing your word before us again, inviting us to engage by the power of your Spirit in that which challenges us, comforts us, teaches us, moves us, gives to us life. Help us as we encounter your living word to be transformed by your grace and love and power. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Friends, our gospel lesson this morning comes to us from the 18th chapter of Luke's gospel, and I begin reading with the first verse, and I invite you again, listen to the word of God. Jesus told them a parable about how they should always pray and never give up. There was once a judge in a certain town, he said, who didn't fear God and didn't have any respect for people. There was a widow in that town, and she came to the judge over and again. Judge my case, she said. Vindicate me against my enemy. And for a long time, he refused. But in the end, he said to himself, it's true. I don't fear God, and I don't have any respect for people. But because this widow is causing me a lot of trouble, I will put her case right and vindicate her, so that she doesn't end up coming and giving me a black eye. Well, said Jesus, do you hear what this unjust judge says? And don't you think that God will see justice done for God's chosen who shout out day and night? Do you suppose that God is deliberately delaying? Let me tell you, God will vindicate very quickly. But when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? This is the word of the Lord. Perhaps it is a strange question, and hopefully obvious on different levels, when we gather in a place like this for the purposes of Christian worship, placing ourselves together before Almighty God in the sanctuary and singing together and reading Scripture together and listening to the Word as it is preached and praying, to ask some questions about prayer. Do you believe in it? Do you practice it regularly? If you were to look at your life today and look back at your life over the last 6 months or 6 years, would you be able to identify ways in which you have grown in prayer, because of prayer, through prayer? And I wonder about this as well. How would you teach someone about prayer and praying? What is it that you perhaps have experienced that you have held on to and that has grown and flourished within you and your experience in such a way that you would pass that on to someone else? Does prayer ever feel risky to you? Are there any times where you are praying and you feel like you are venturing out into deep waters, and perhaps that you are engaging in something that is not simply familiar and comfortable, but instead something that is risky and exciting? You see, the story that is before us about Jesus and his disciples today is a story where Jesus says that there was a need, and that there is a need to pray always and never to lose faith. But then the story that Jesus tells about that is a doozy if you take it seriously and try to walk through it. Because when I read that story, what comes to mind for me, and I wonder perhaps for you as well, have you ever been worried when you were asking for something? Have you ever sat down across the desk for someone with someone and what you desperately needed was for them to give you a job? And you were worried about that particular ask. Or perhaps you began to have a relationship with someone that was a wonderful friendship, and you felt like perhaps it was going to go a little bit further and that there were next steps to be taken, but you knew that the next step was for you to ask them out on a date. And were you worried a little about that ask? Have you ever been worried about asking for help from someone? You needed something that only they could provide, or at least you knew that you didn't have it in you to make whatever happened or needed to happen to take place. And so you had to ask for money, or you had to ask for friendship or forgiveness. Have you ever had to ask, and at the same time, that asking was done with anxiety or with worry? Or perhaps different. Have you ever asked for something and not received it, and then asked again and not received it, and then asked again and not received it, and finally got to the place where you thought to yourself, I can't keep asking? What made you quit? What was it that made you stop asking? It wasn't that the need had diminished or gone away, but something caused you stop. Well, Jesus told a parable, not just an illustration about prayer, but a parable, one of those stories wherein we are invited to find ourselves and our role in it, where Jesus says something but doesn't say everything, and often tells a story that's a bit confusing, or perhaps that leaves us wanting to know more about what's going on. And because of that, we are invited in. And here Luke tells us the punchline of the story before the story comes. He says, this is a story about the need to pray always and to never, ever give up. And of all the possibilities and all the characters that Jesus could have used in such a story, these are the ones that Jesus picks. A judge. And when we hear the word judge, we assume that this is a person who is going to have some gravitas and some wisdom, and somebody who is a good decision maker and cares about the cases and the people that are before the judge. But that's not the judge that we get. What we know about this judge is that this judge did not fear God and didn't really care about people or what they thought about the judge. And then the next character that Jesus introduces us to is a widow. And in this culture, identifying someone as a widow is lifting them up with the understanding that in many, many ways, they are no longer a person in that culture. Their rights are taken away. Their power has been diminished. They have no standing and no influence. The only way that they are going to make it is when others will stand up on their behalf and give to them the support that they cannot bring to bear themselves. The one thing in this story that we should know about a widow is that a widow has no leverage whatsoever. But in this story, we wonder about that. Does she? Is there something that she could do? Is there something that she is doing that might bring about the change that is needed? You see, Jesus tells this story about all of these people and identifies the characters almost as a caricature. The judge who is supposed to have wisdom and thoughtfulness and ability to do justice, we are told, has none of that and doesn't seem to care at all. And the widow is a person who by definition has no standing and no power. But what does she have? What is the one thing that separates this widow from her identifying markers? Persistence. Never, ever, ever quit. Again and again and again. She refuses that this judge will not hear her case, that this judge will not give to her justice, that this judge will not do right by her. And the way Jesus tells the story, finally, not because the judge becomes a good person or a God-fearing person, but because the judge finally is worn out with this woman coming over and over. And in fact, worried about a black eye is the way the scripture reads. The judge relents and the judge grants her what is needed. And Jesus tells us that this is a story about prayer. Really? Is it a good story about prayer? I'm not sure. But it's the story that we have. And we're invited into it. And when we enter into the story and identify with one or more of the characters, it seems pretty obvious that on the front end, we're the widow. And God is the judge. And what are we told? Never quit. Never give up. Keep going over and over again without worry about embarrassment or weariness. You see, in this story, if the judge and God are identified one with the other, this is not the story about God as a loving parent or merciful Lord. Not the story about one who is warm and engaged. Instead, it's a story about distance and indifference. The judge comes to us as cynical and perhaps even bored, without shame, with no fear or respect. And Jesus says to us, friends, sometimes that is what prayer is like. Over and over and over and over again. You have this desperate widow and you have this cynical judge. And in that story, I don't know about you, but I despise the idea that this is who and how and whether and what God is like. And I'm very grateful that this is not the only story that we have about God and about us and about prayer. But in this story, what Jesus is lifting up for us is that the outcome depends upon that persistence, that never losing heart and continuing to ask and to ask and to knock and to seek and to place ourselves before the Almighty over and over and over again. If this were the only story that we had about praying and about prayer, that would be bad news indeed. But there is some good news for us, and there is some directive and direction that we are given. For what we find first is that this is a story about hope. You see, the one thing that the widow was absolutely certain of was that she could not be the one who made the difference that needed to be made in her life. And so she went to the judge and was never, ever going to give up until she got what she needed. And she believed that change would come. She, like us, understood that the hope that we have is that there is power that is beyond our ability. And that part of our role in prayer is simply to continue to ask that God will intervene and that God will act and that God will make
a difference. The next thing we find is that you cannot escape, that this is a story about justice. You see, what she was praying for was vindication, as I read it, or justice. And it calls for us to engage in that conversation as well, about justice and about what is right for us to pray for. When you hear that word justice, what comes to mind? What are the things that you think about relative to this notion of justice? Is it dignity for children? Is it schools being made available for everyone? Is it food for the hungry and shelter for the homeless? Is it respect that all people deserve? I don't know what's on your list, but when you read this story, it calls us to engage in that conversation alongside this widow about justice and never, ever giving up. The last thing about this story that strikes me is something that I like to think of as the faithfulness of a black eye. Now, that's a crazy thing to imagine, isn't it? But let me ask you this. Have you ever had a black eye? And when you have a black eye and you leave your home and you go out in public, what happens? Somebody wants to know the story that goes with it. And I'm struck here about how Jesus tells this story about finally this notion that there was going to be someone who would have to tell the story about the black eye. And because of that, acted. Now, again, this idea that it's God who has the black eye and therefore I can only push so far. But if I think about us, if I think about myself, what is it that pushes me? What is it that motivates me toward justice and toward acting on behalf of another? Of course, my hope is that it's not a black eye that it would take in order to act, right? But the story that's here invites us to consider, what is it that does give to us the motivation to do the things that we are supposed to do? If we turn this story upside down and backwards and recognize that there are those who come to us asking not only for mercy and for help, but indeed asking us to engage in a struggle that has to do with justice, will we remember this parable and that potential that's there about how it's going to be and how we are going to appear and look when we refuse to act on behalf of those who are, in fact, powerless? You see, when Jesus tells this story, it's no accident that Jesus chooses a widow as the primary character and invites us in prayer and to persistence and to a conversation about justice. You see, the calling that is on us is not only that we would never quit, that we would pray always, but that we, paying attention to who and how it is that God acts on behalf of the powerless, that we too would be those who believe and act and live towards justice. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, in response to God's word, let us stand together. Let us proclaim our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed, and giving answer to that great question, Christians, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Let us pray. Loving God, we're grateful to you for gathering us in this sanctuary, for giving us breath, life, and your love while you care for our needs. We thank you for all who have taught us and still teach us the faith that is a firm foundation for our lives as individuals and in community. You call us on a journey for which we are uncertain, and along the way we find comfort in the presence of the Holy Spirit as our fears are calmed, our hearts are opened, and our minds are expanded. Guide us, O God, to go in your path without question or concern, knowing you will give us the strength to face the trials. Keep us always in movement aligned with the direction of the Holy Spirit, and help us to trust in you so strongly we willingly put down our oars, even as we become uncomfortable and afraid of newness and uncertainty. At this time when the world seems confused, make us your servants for those who hunger for peace and not division. For people whose souls clamor for justice, void of all greed or violence, and for those longing for relief from the gnawing of hunger and fear of starvation, empower us to feed your sheep and quench the thirst of those in need of clean water. Make us friends to the strangers next door, the handicapped, the addicted, and the outcast. Make us mindful of those without clothes and those living with the anxiety of loss, whether it's loss of income, memory, stability, or relationship. Be with all who are sick, waiting for diagnosis, those awaiting transplants, those in the midst of treatment and in prayer for a cure. Be with those who are sick from the ills and disappointments of life, those in our midst with troubled hearts and anxious minds. Give us the tools to free others as we speak of your love. Lay your comforting hands upon us, O God, that we may be the church for those caught in unjust systems, those denied education or health care, those in need of human touch and hope for the future. We pray this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, praying together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Over the past week or so, many of our sailboat small groups have begun, giving us feedback early on in the study. The feedback is positive, and the comment or questions we're hearing the most is, I'm not sure I understand the sailing church concept, and that is anticipated after only one of these gatherings. As the studies continue, we are reminded The bedrock reality of life is that God, through the power at work within us, can do abundantly far more than we could ever ask or imagine. Our ministry is fully carried out when our hearts are full of love, justice, and generosity in sharing the gifts given to us. Your generosity provides far more than we could ever ask or imagine. We will now receive God's tithes and our offerings. God of generosity, you have given us so much that enrich our lives, and we give you thanks. We thank you for your love and faithfulness, and acknowledge all that we have belongs to you. Bless these gifts and use them in service to others. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Friends, in just a moment, if you are a member of our congregation, you are invited to remain for a brief congregational meeting. Friends, as we go out from this place today, may we be ever more aware of the invitation that God gives to us of faithfulness, of love, of joy, and of grace. And along the way, may we also recognize and know that God is calling us to persevere and to persist, even and especially in our prayers. Now may the living Lord Jesus go with you. May he go above you to watch over you, behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, within you to give you peace, and before you to show you the way, this day and forevermore. Amen. Seated. Madam Clerk, have we a quorum present? Friends, we have a quorum present, so I'm going to invite us to engage in our meeting. Will you pray with me? God, continue to give to us the grace and guidance of your Holy Spirit as we consider the work of Christ's Church as it is made manifest here at First Presbyterian of Beaufort, and now, through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Friends, the purpose of our meeting, as stated, is to hear a report from the nominating committee of our church that we would elect an elder to fulfill the term in 2000. Owen, remind me, it's 22, right? 22? Okay. We have one spot in 2022, and we have an incredible candidate who has agreed to stand for the election, Mary Ragsdale. Would you mind, Mary, standing so that everyone can see you? Thank you. It is proper for me at this point to also ask if there are any other nominations from the floor. And seeing none, we will close the nominations. And I will ask all of you who are in favor for Mary Ragsdale to serve as our elder, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And I'm going to ask, having seen all of the ayes, that if you are also inclined that we close our meeting, that you stand. So, Madam Clerk, let the record reflect that the ayes have it, that Mary Ragsdale is elected, and that there has also been a mass demonstration that folks are ready to move on. Let us pray. God, of the many ways that you gift us, we are most especially grateful for the call that you place upon our lives to serve within your church as deacons, as elders, as ministers of word and sacrament, as Sunday school teachers, as committee members, as youth leaders, as parents, as friends, as disciples of Jesus Christ. And we ask that as you continue to call us, that you will continue to equip us and send us out from this place to show by our action and by our word that Jesus Christ is Lord. And all of God's people said, Amen. Friends, you are invited, because I can see outside that the weather is wonderful for us, to please come over and have a moment to visit and fellowship at a Plaza Social. Go in peace.